Hello, everyone. Welcome to 2023. I hope you guys had a good holiday. It has taken me, more years on the planet than I care to admit to finally figure out what my favorite holiday truly is. And for a long time, I thought it was Christmas. And it's not Christmas. It's actually that week before, that week between Christmas and New Year's. I told my daughter this yesterday and she's like, limbo? Everybody hates limbo. I'm like, no, that's like the perfect time of year because all of the presents are wrapped. I'm not cooking for 20 people and I can just relax. No decorations have to go up. No decorations have to go down. Everybody's just kind of going, eh, you know, about everything. And it's just like the perfect time of year. So, I don't know, like put over there in the comments, what is your favorite holiday? I know that that time between Christmas and New Year's technically isn't a holiday, but we treat it as such. So what is your favorite? For a while, I thought it was Thanksgiving too, but no, I think it's just the laziness of that week between Christmas and New Year's where I can watch some silly shows. Like I recently got involved with 1883, which is a prequel to Yellowstone. I have not watched Yellowstone. But anyway, it's about the pioneers. It's about the Oregon Trail. And I came away after watching that with one very clear thought is that I would have perished pretty darn quickly on the Oregon Trail. Our ancestors were certainly much stronger than I am. And it's amazing that we're even on this planet still because I certainly would not have made it very long as a pioneer. The number of things that can kill you and can go wrong were so well portrayed in that 1883 show, and I just thought, my goodness, I'm lucky to be here, and I'm glad that my ancestors were stronger than I am. So that's really what I did after Christmas, is I watched that, we binge watched 1883, and then there's another one, 1923, that's with Harrison Ford and Helen Mirren. Also great, but anyway, it was just a nice welcome way to kind of pass the days and the times. So what other favorite holidays are people talking about, Jesse?
Let's see, Andrea's favorite holiday is the day after, when everyone goes home.
Everybody goes home, right, it's just a quiet house, and nobody's looking at you going, what's for dinner now? Like, you just get to relax and decide. Yeah, I agree, Andrea. It's a great time. Yeah, for sure. Any others?
I think everyone's still just saying hello.
Hello, yeah. What cities do we have showing up today?
Let's see. We've got Armstrong in Canada.
Armstrong in Canada. Oh, goodness. I don't know enough about Canada to know where Armstrong in Canada is. I wish I did. Where else?
Idaho Falls.
Idaho Falls. Fabulous. I would like to go to Idaho. Speaking of pioneers, I would like to go to Idaho Falls. Where else?
Minnesota, where they're enjoying an extended winter break.
Minnesota. You know, if Minnesota is like, yeah, there's too much snow to go to school, kids, you know it's a lot of snow because Minnesota can deal with snow. Here in Louisville, we cannot deal with snow. And we certainly had a massive storm Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, just like the rest of the country. It was very, very cold. And we were all, those who did not have their pipes frozen, were just thankful that that did not happen because the likelihood was quite high. Well, we have a lot of great things planned for you today, and we have a lot of great things planned for you within 2023 as well. So each year we kind of pick a theme to talk about, and going back, we've been doing this so many years now. One year we did the Year of the Feathers, where we just went all through like basic feathers and basic spines, all the way up to how to do a double-sided feathered wreath. And of course, all of these are over on YouTube. If you ever want to go and kind of pull apart some of these lessons, they're all over on our YouTube channel. So you can see them all recorded there. So that was one year where we did just feathers all year long. And then we did another year that was all about the grid and how to use grid designs in blocks and borders, sashings, and as all overs. That was the Year of the Grid. And then this past year, we did all about, in 2022, We did all about rulers and all different ways to use rulers, from straight edge rulers up to more kind of funky shaped rulers, kind of specialty rulers, like flower rulers or even clamshell kind of rulers. So all different rulers. So when looking at 2023 and what we wanted to chat with you guys about in 2023, we're going to focus 2023 on specific blocks and how to quilt very specific blocks. And what we're going to do is we have our second live stream of the month, and that's on the third Wednesday at the same time at that 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. And in that third live stream that we do, we're going to go through how to piece the block that we're going to talk about. So we're going to show how to piece it, and then the next that next month we're going to show how to quilt that specific quilt block. So unfortunately, we cannot start this January. We can't start in 2 weeks because this in 2 weeks I'm going to be in Cave City, Kentucky. I don't know if you've ever I'm sure you've heard of Mammoth Cave, right? Cave City is in the Mammoth Cave area, and of course, Mammoth Cave is this massive cave underground national park we have here in Kentucky, and there's a big quilt educational event that happens near that area each year. And so I'm the featured speaker and educator this year at the, it's called the Jabez Quilt Symposium, I think. Is it a symposium? And so there's a lot of other teachers as well, but there's all kinds of educational classes, and I will be teaching all day, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, as well as evening lectures. So I'm going to be worn out. So I will not have the time or availability to chat with you all like we normally do for that January live stream that we do on the third Wednesday of the month. So we are going to start in February. I'm going to kind of, in February at Clubhouse, just kind of lay out in more detail and give you some examples of what we're going to be talking about. And then in the February 3rd Wednesday of the month, we're actually going to piece a block together. And so we'll be there with my FAF creative icon, and I'll be piecing the block that we're going to use. And then in the March Clubhouse, we're going to show how to actually quilt that specific block. So they all go into, we've got the everything kind of designed for you. So I'm going to lay all that out when we meet back together in the February, our February 1st, Wednesday, February 1st at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. So that we've got so much stuff planned for you for 2023, but that's going to be like the core of our educational content for 2023. So be sure you sign up for our newsletter, because in our newsletter, we will go through and remind you. And if we have any downloadable worksheets or tutorials, all of that is in our newsletter. And of course, anything that we want to crow about or tell you about or talk to you about, that's all in that newsletter. And we generally send those out 2 times a week-ish. So go ahead and sign up there. Make sure that you're signed up, and we'll send you some reminders too about watching the live stream so you can join in the fun as we kind of explore specific quilt blocks and how to quilt those specific quilt blocks. And then we do have our monthly thread pack. So our monthly thread pack for January is the Princess Pixie. And she has 3 different beautiful colors in the pack. It's First Kiss, Maroon, and Starlight. They're just gorgeous, and they're all glide thread. You can get them either in the small cone, so the 1,000 meter cone, or in the king cone, that's 5,000 meter. But that's our January thread pack, and so it's a special deal for you. That's only good through the month of January, and then our Princess Pixie will fly away, and we'll have our February fairy that we'll announce on February the 1st. And then if you are looking for any kind of instruction for stand-up quilting, for long arm quilting, I do have a beginning long arm class that will be taught virtually through Zoom. And that is going to be on February the 11th. And we will go through in that class how to set tension, needles, thread, batting, how to load, how to realign for a pantograph, how to use a pantograph. All of that is in that class. If you have recently purchased an APQS long arm machine, then, and you have not taken your beginner's class that comes with your purchase, we can get you signed up and you can take this class for free, the beginning long arm class for me for free. Just send us an email and we can get all of the needed credentials to get you in that class. If you have a different brand machine or an older APQS machine, you're of course welcome to purchase the class and join us in our virtual classroom. I will be teaching that day all day. It's a 10 to 4 class. Lots of places for questions. We do it with multiple cameras so you can get a really good view of everything that we talk about. And we really get into the weeds of long arm quilting, stand up quilting. So hopefully you will be able to join me then. And I do want to, so we're going to talk about different edge-to-edge designs today. So the best way to kind of attack edge-to-edge designs. Now, pantographs, if you've heard that word, a panto, pantograph, edge-to-edge, all the same thing. It just means that you're following basically a printed pattern normally, if you're not using a computer. You're following a printed pattern to stitch a consistent design across your quilt top. And you stitch from one edge to the other edge. So that's why it's called edge-to-edge quilting. You don't stop for blocks or borders or sashing. So generally you're following a pre-printed something you've purchased. But I wanted to show you how to do it free motion where you didn't necessarily need to buy anything. And these will be very, very simple designs that I'm going to show you. So what I've done first, and I hope that, Ashley, can you see this? I just blocked out, because this is plain fabric, and so it's a little bit hard to show you what it would look like on a pieced quilt without kind of drawing in seam lines for you. So basically, I've given myself 3-inch blocks here, and rows of 3-inch blocks, and then just given a little line here for the center. Because I just want to show you, generally when you quilt, of course, you've got a pieced pattern that was, you can use the seams from the piecing to your advantage, so you don't have to actually mark anything. And I'm going to just start up here, I think. Ashley, I'm just going to show, so a really easy, simple beginner design. It's just lowercase L's. So let's take a look at that. Pretty simple, right? Just lowercase L, super duper simple. One little tiny step up from that a lot of times that makes it just a little fancier is to mix in a lowercase e with a lowercase L. So a lowercase e with a lowercase L. A lowercase e with a lowercase L. So that's a super simple, I'm just gonna move my machine over here. So that's a super simple kind of beginner way to get started with free motion quilting that's nice in a border. What we're going to do though is we're going to use it as an all over edge to edge design. So I've got those 3-inch squares kind of placed here on the fabric, and I have that little mark just giving me an indication of where the center of that 3-inch square is. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put a large lowercase L right along that center. So I place a lowercase L here, and now I'm going to drop down and do a lowercase L, upside down L in this next one. So a big loop, and then a big loop, and then a big loop, and then a big loop. And I would use the piecing, all right, I'm going to stop there. I would use the piecing on my quilt to give me these registration lines. I marked it on the fabric because it's just a giant piece of red fabric. Okay, so that's what I've done so far is I've just done a lowercase L going up and a lowercase L going down, a lowercase up, a lowercase L, up, up, up. All right, so let's look at how we might be able to do this the next time. So for this next one, what I want to do is I'm just going to drop down one more little layer, and I'm just going to repeat it. So I'm going to go in the same direction. I'm not going to cross over anything. I'm just going to do the same one. Up and down. And up and down. And up and down. And I'm going to stop it there. And then I'm going to, I moved the camera, Ashley. Hopefully that didn't hurt anything. I put it back where I thought it was. Okay. All right, and then so here we're building, right? We're building, we're building, we're building, we're building. Let's do one more layer. Again, I'm just gonna repeat the direction. So I'm just doing row upon row upon row. Up, down, up, down, up, down. All right, I would take some tacking stitches. Of course, I would go clear across the quilt. We're just doing it a little bit just because I want to build this out so you can see it. Oop. pull that thread up. All right, let's do one more. And so I'm at the bottom here, and I'm just going to fill it out. I think I'm going to need to reseat my bobbin. There it goes. So just use the actual piecing seam lines as your marks, as your registration lines. Then you don't have to worry about anything. It's all done for you. So again, up. Now this time I don't have a down, so I'm just going to sneak through. Up. And I'm just going to sneak through. Up. And then I'm just going to sneak through, and I'm done. Okay, so let me break my threads here, and let me show you what we built. Super duper duper simple stuff. So, I got caught on that little needle plate. All right, so here's what we built. Really easy. And that's with 3-inch lines. That's with 3-inch squares. So you could even go bigger, but you can see how it just adds texture. And I don't have to follow a pattern. I can just do it free motion. In my head, I'm just thinking lowercase L, lowercase cursive L's over and over and over again to build that out. Okay, so let's look at one other thought. Now I haven't drawn my 3-inch grid over here, but we will pretend that I have. So it's not gonna be as, if you notice over here, it looks pretty symmetrical, right? And that's because I marked those 3-inch piecing lines before I started. So this time we're gonna just do it a little bit different. And this time I'm actually gonna go up, over, down, over, up, over, down, over, up, over, down, over, up, and I would continue on. I'm going to break my threads here so that we can go back and start this next row. And by the way, yes, I could go back in the direction I just came, but any long arm machine is just going to have a little bit of an easier time moving from left to right. So in general, if you have that choice, go ahead and take it. It'll just make for a nicer stitch. So I'm just gonna repeat that same idea. Over, down, over, up, over, down, over, up, over, down, over, up. All right, let's do one more row, just so that I know you've got it. All right, we're gonna tighten that camera down just a bit here. Yeah, so let me do it without stitching, just so you see the path that I took. So here I went up, over, almost like a star, like you're gonna make a star, down, over, up, over, down, over, up, over, down. So that was one. Now if you remember, we just did it with those loops, with those lowercase L's. So imagine if this wasn't the straight, if this was a loop. So this is where I would have done that lowercase L here, and then I would have done the lowercase L here, and then a lowercase L here. So it's the same path that we used. It's just instead of a curvy line, I'm using straight lines. Let's see if I can do one more row and have it cooperate the camera. I'll go a little slower. So I go up, over, and I'm gonna go down, over, up, and I'm going into that space that I left from the row before, and down, and over, and up, and over, and down. Was that a little better to see? Going a little slower?
I think so. Would you adjust the camera just a little bit towards the, there we go.
So that is the pattern that we just kind of did on the fly. And all I'm doing is I'm just adding some texture. It's just that would be for straight lines as opposed to what we did over here, which was those L's, more curvy lines. So if you are looking for an easy edge-to-edge design that will just add texture, start with this one. Start with this lowercase L to the top, lowercase L to the bottom, lowercase L to the top, lowercase L to the bottom. Start with this one and get that in your brain. And once this path is in your brain, then transforming it from a curly shape to a straight line shape, the straight line shape will be much easier on your brain. So going from here will be easier on your brain once you see that that's simply where you would have put an L, and then you would have put an L, and then you would have put an L, and then you would have put an L. It's the same path, it's just straight instead of curvy. And I'm kind of giving away the end here, but we're gonna talk in a minute about a quilt. I wanna show you how I would quilt if it were my quilt, and it kind of illuminates why this style of all over edge to edge can really come in handy sometimes. There are certain quilts that if you put a standard pantograph on, it's not gonna sing in the way that it could if you chose something more simple that has more repetitiveness, that has more texture to it, as opposed to a design. So I'm gonna show you that here in just a minute so that you can clearly see that. Do we have any questions about that process there, Jesse?
I don't think I have any questions so far.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, if you have any questions, pop them over there in the chat and we will certainly address them. All right, so I'm gonna show you that kind of method and why I would choose this method when we go to look at this quilt here in just a minute. I did wanna say thank you to our sponsor, APQS. APQS long arm machines are 100% handcrafted in Iowa and they are loved the world over. They do have a lifetime warranty. If you are interested in an APQS long arm machine or computer system to go on your APQS long arm machine, give us a call here at Quilted Joy or connect with your local APQS dealer, your local APQS store, or contact APQS at APQS.com. Thanks so much for your support, APQS. We love you. All right, I have a great Looky Loo to show you today. We always love kind of being nosy and see how other people have their studios, their home studios set up. And you're gonna love Jill's space. Jill has just a gorgeous area that she has carved out of her home, and pay attention to what she's using to house her thread. I really enjoy that. All right, let's see Jill's sewing room. Hi, Jill. How are you?
I'm well. Good to see you, Angela. How are you?
Good to see you. I'm good. Thank you so much for joining me. Where are you? What state are you in?
I'm in Washington State, way out on that other Washington on the West Coast. We're in Edmonds, which is about 15 miles north of Seattle. So Puget Sound area.
Wow. I am sure it is gorgeous.
It is gorgeous.
Well, so you have is your sewing studio in your basement? Is it in a shop? How do you have it set up?
My sewing studio is smack dab in my house. We live upstairs in a house and my mom and dad live downstairs. And when we moved in, my husband and son were kind enough to say, you can have the formal living room and dining room for your sewing space, because we have other space that we hang out with for the family and another dining area. So you walk right through my door when my customers come in and there you are. Here we are.
Awesome. All right. I can't wait. Okay. Show, if you would turn that camera around so we can see your space.
You bet.
So you were at the front door before and now you're like, it's right there.
I was. You walk into the living room and my long arm is right there. I got a Christmas quilt on it right now because it's that time of year.
I love it.
You know?
Love it.
And then,
and all those windows.
Yeah, lots of light. Very nice, bright space, that's for sure. And then we kind of rotate and turn around a little bit. And that's actually where the rest of the work gets done. My own sewing, all my supplies, customer quilts, that kind of stuff.
And so you've got batting suspended under that table, so then you can just pull it up and cut it on that table.
I do. You know, it's funny. Lots of people talk about how their husbands designed that for them. I just want to say I designed that. Thank you.
There
Yeah,
you go. There you go. Very nice.
that worked well. And probably one of my most favorite parts of this room is what looks to you like a china cabinet here, but in reality is a thread cabinet. I know you probably thought that
Love
china
it.
cabinet, right?
Love it.
That belonged to my grandmother, and we had it in the living room for a while, and I'm just not much of a china person. And one day I was looking at it and looking at my threads that were stacked up on another bookshelf, and I got this brainstorm to put the thread inside the china cabinet, and it worked really well. So I'm really thankful for that.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Beautifully, because it does. It looks like
It
candy
does,
behind
you know. And
glass.
since my long arm studio is, you know, in the middle of my home, it kind of needs to look a little homish. And so I have used furniture that you might use in your home as opposed to office furniture, that kind of stuff. So yeah, it works very well. Good.
Very
It's good,
nice.
good space. I really enjoy it. Yeah.
All right. And so you have your long arm machine. Can you turn around
Sure.
to that? So is it a 12 foot, a 10 foot? How
I
big is
have a
the
big old
table?
12-foot Lucy here,
A 12 foot Lucy.
whom I love. I have just enough space behind her to get back there. I'm fortunate enough right now to be using an IQ, but before I had that, of course, I had to stand at the back and do my pantographs from the back. But now I get to do it from the front because I'm using IQ.
Wonderful. And so
Yeah.
where so you have all your thread there in the cabinet, and then I
Right.
saw you have a roll of batting under that one cutting table, and then you've got, is that the only kind of batting that you use? Is that one kind?
I use Hobbs 8020, the cotton poly, which is what you see under the table there. Excuse me. And then, you know, when you're in your living room, you got to use all the space you have. So you'll see just tucked away in the corner over there,
Oh,
the
yeah.
Hobbs wool that I use. And then peeking out underneath the Christmas quilt, I don't know if you can see that, but there are a couple of
There, yeah,
rolls underneath
several
there
rolls.
too.
Yeah.
So
And so where's your domestic machine?
my domestic machine is, I use it on this table when I'm sewing, and it's just around the corner there. It's in a bag because as a long arm quilter, I honestly don't get a lot of time to quilt my own quilts, unfortunately. So it's in a bag a lot. And I pull it out and use it on the table when I'm making my own quilts, which I am actually doing there on that back bureau. I have a stack of fabrics that I've cut out and I'm starting to work on right now. So.
And so you've got all of your fabric. I see it organized over there by color in the
Right,
corner.
right. That was my COVID project, was washing all of my fabric and folding it nicely and color coordinating it.
Yeah, get it
Yeah.
organized. It is certainly a project. Well, Jill, can you turn that camera around so we can see you?
You bet. Let's see.
There you are. Awesome. Well, tell me three things that you're into right now that you'd recommend to your bestie. They don't have to be quilt related, but what are three cool things you're into right now?
I think probably like many people, I spend a fair bit of time on social media. And one of the things that I would really want to say to anybody who's quilting is to be kind to yourself, to don't compare yourself to everybody else on social media because it doesn't do any good. And I started out doing that when I first started long arming. And I thought, oh, I first started long arming. And I thought, oh my goodness, I will never be able to do those kinds of things. And I still can't do all of those kinds of things. But practice is really important to get to where you want to go. And you know, if it's important enough to you, and you practice, you will get there. So hang in there. So that's a big thing. One of the things I appreciate about your Facebook page, actually, Angela, is that you feature women who have done their first quilt on a long arm machine. It's not, you know, beautiful, gorgeous, but they did it and it looks great. And that's a real great encouragement, I think, to folks who are starting out at the beginning. So.
Yeah, I find a lot of times folks, maybe they've sewn on a domestic machine for
decades. Mm-hmm. And they go to a longer machine expecting it to just kind of flow because they're used to their sit-down machine. And it's a completely different beast. It's really another great thing to learn, but you have to give yourself the grace and the kindness to allow yourself to take those baby steps and allow yourself to bump your nose and figure things out.
I also joined a group of long armors in the area. And that's just a wonderful way both to encourage yourself and to get extra help, you know, learn from other people. The folks in that group actually let me try out their long arm machines before I chose an APQS. So I got to drive a couple of different types of long arm machines before I had to choose. And that was a real gift. It was scary. You know, you're going to let me hold onto your machine and move it. Oh, my goodness. But that community is really important. And it's out there. It's out there for us as quilters, but it's also really out there for those who are long arming, too. So make use of the resources that are out there for you in the community. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm glad that you have that group. That's awesome, Jill. Well, Jill, if people want to connect with you online, where can they find you?
I have a website, which is comfortandjoyquilter.com. And then I'm also on Facebook and Instagram under the same name, Comfort and Joy Quilter. Unfortunately, Comfort and Joy Quilts was already taken. So the next best thing is Comfort and Joy Quilter. And that's where you can find me.
Nice. Well, thank you so much, Jill. I really appreciate it. And I will see you around the clock.
Thank you, Angela. Bye-bye.
All right, thanks. Bye.
Thanks so much, Jill. Don't you love her space? And Jill, kudos to your family for giving you all the room to kind of spread out and spread joy throughout your home with your quilting. I really loved how you made that China hutch sing with the thread. It looks gorgeous in there. So thank you so much. I would love to come and sew in your space, Jill. It's just gorgeous. And by the way, I would love to schedule a video chat with you to see your sewing space. So do we have a link that we could put up? So you can go there and you can put your information in and then we'll reach out and we can schedule a video time to chat with you to get a tour of your room. And don't worry, you don't have to have it looking sparkling clean. Like I'm going to be nosy and, you know, want to see where you keep your thread. So don't think that you have to have a glorious studio like Jill does. It might be a basement studio like I had in my old house, my new house. It is a walk-in closet with a bare bulb. So whatever works for you, I would just love to see it and love to see your space. So you can go there and sign up to be to have a video chat with me during our Looky Loo. I'd love to chat with you. I wanted to let you know we do have some new arrivals here in the shop. Take a look at this one. This one is the Tula Pink project bag, and it is 20 inches by 20 inches. It's vinyl, and it has a zipper here at the top, and the zipper has the little Tula Pink logo there on the end of it. And then take a look at Mr. Owl. Isn't he glorious? And so you can put your projects in here, his feathers and everything, and look at the detail and all of the leaves for Mr. Owl, and it's got the stars and has the moon and his talons on the branch. Really beautiful project bag. And then we also have, this one is another Tula Pink project bag. And again, it's zippered and it has the little Tula Pink hardware logo on there. And this one is a 14 by 10 project bag. And it's all lemurs. So it's all black and white with, of course, her colorful dot lemur style, that line style that she loves. And then this one, look at that bee. Isn't that great? So this one is the 18 by 13 project bag called Kabloom, and it has this beautiful cabbage rose here on it with the bee. And again, it's got that zipper at the top, so you can pop your projects in here and then zip them back up and kind of take them to and from. So if you're traveling like to a class or something, it's a good way to kind of take all of your pieces you may have pre-cut and kind of keep things organized while also looking super glam at the same time. So those are some new arrivals. We have a bunch of other new things that have come into the shop, including our waved collection. So it's a nice blender or basic, and we have it in loads of different colors. And that's from Paintbrush Studios. So we have those in the 45, and we're about to put up on the website. We have them also in the 108. So give us like a week or so, and we'll have those other, those larger ones up on the website too. But they're really nice blenders and basics, and they make for a nice quilt back as well. And then our personal favorite here in the shop, we always like get out the mini charm pack. It's a koi mini charm pack, and we're always just oohing and aahing over the little fish that are on this koi mini charm pack. And when you do get the mini charm pack from Quilt of Joy, we will pop in there a free pattern along with that mini charm pack as well. It'll make a table runner with some background fabric that you may have on hand. So those are some new arrivals that we have, and I would ask that if you find our Quilt of Joy Clubhouse helpful, that you leave us a review on Google. You know, the Google monster has a lot of power on how they present small businesses and who they present small businesses to. And so your review on Google will help the Google monster see that we should be served up to other folks. So it really does help us grow, and I appreciate your time. So if you would send us a, leave us a review on Google, that would be most helpful. And I do read every single one, and I certainly appreciate your time. All right, so in our Quilted Joy Clubhouse there on Facebook, we have a group on Facebook. We'd love for you to join us. I think we're up to like 5,000 strong now in our Facebook group, full of the most helpful, wonderful, nicest, kindest quilters. A lot of folks will post on there, you know, here's a quilt. I don't know quite how to quilt it. How would you quilt it if it was your quilt? And other people will give suggestions. And of course, people do post finished quilts on there so we can all celebrate. But once a month, we do put out a call saying, hey, is there a quilt you would like to be submitted for the Quilted Joy Clubhouse How Would You Quilt It segment? And so I choose one of the quilts that are submitted and show you how I would quilt it if it were my quilt. We had lots of great entries this month, so pop over to Facebook and see all the other quilts that were submitted. There's some really gorgeous ones. This is the one that I chose because it kind of lends into what we were talking about earlier. So this one is from Kembra, and it's very dramatic, right? It's got those grays and the blacks, kind of making a frame with a medallion star in the center, and then some yellow kind of focal blocks off onto the four corners. So the challenge here with Kembra quilt, and I'm just going to zoom in here so you can see it a little bit better. So the challenge here with this quilt is when you are confronted with fabrics that are kind of wild like this, and lots of them, it can be a challenge to know what to quilt on it. I mean, take a look at those fabrics in the quilt. There's hexagons, there's chevrons, there's stripes, there's polka dots on a string, like so, so many different kinds of fabrics. And the challenge is, if I were to put, I'm gonna zoom out here for just a minute, if I were to just put a regular old pantograph on top of that, an edge to edge pantograph on top of it, it could get lost because there's just so dang much going on. I don't want my quilting to fight with all of those different fabrics. So I'm going to show you some regular old pantographs that probably that are gorgeous on their own, but would not look so great on Kembra's quilt. Do you see how that design would look a little busy? Like there's so much going on with her fabrics that to add a busy pantograph on top of it would just kind of get to be a little much, a little bit too much, even though it's a gorgeous pantograph. Here's another one that's gorgeous. That one, beautiful. But again, if I were to stitch that design out edge to edge on her quilt, I think all that hard work would just get lost because the fabric is going to kind of overtake that quilting design. Here's another one. Let's say that the recipient, if you're in the city of Louisville, this is our symbol is the fleur-de-lis. And let's say we wanted to put a fleur-de-lis on it. Well, again, it's just going to look a little busy. There's just so much going on that it would get lost on Kembra's quilt. So let's go back here to Kembra's quilt. So we had talked earlier in the show about kind of an all over edge to edge that would give you, that would be simple, and it would give you just kind of texture. So let's look at how we might do that on Kembra's quilt. So I'm going to just start here after this block. So I'm looking at her blocks here, and I don't know how big these blocks are, Kembra. I'm going to guess they're 3 inches. But if you take a look, these two, this block is made of 2 1.5 inch strips, and they're going top to bottom. And then this one, the 1.5 inch strips now are on the equator. And so they're going to east, west, north, south, east-west, north-south, east-west, north-south, east-west. So the piecing itself has given us the outline, the registration lines that we need in order to do that very simple pantograph we were working with earlier. So just like we were working with earlier, I can come in here, I can do my lowercase l, drop down, lowercase l, come up, lowercase l, drop down, lowercase l, come up, lowercase l, and just start building. And there's so much going on here in the fabrics and everything that if I'm slightly off, you're just not gonna see it. Okay, now I'm ready for the next row. So I'm gonna go lowercase l. I'm just gonna repeat it. I'm not altering it, I'm repeating it. So that this whole row, the L's are all going in the same direction as the prior L's. So I'm just gonna keep building this out and using, I wouldn't have to mark anything. I would be using the piecing to show me exactly where I'm headed. Now, these little parts up here, up at the very top, I will have to come in and just sneak and fill those in, sneak and fill those in. To give myself all of that space with this very simple background design. And so it won't fight with all these fabrics. It will just complement because it's gonna just add a repetitive texture to the eye and let the fabrics do all the talking. The quilting's just gonna be a foundation and a base for all of those fabrics to happen. All right, so let's see if I can pull up. So here's what I originally looked at. Now, I did it, Kembra, over the center and the outside blocks. Like truly an all over edge to edge. And then I thought, you know, I bet Kembra is gonna want to set that center star off a little bit and not have the edge to edge go over the top of that center star. So then I started thinking about how Kembra, I could work with your center star to give it some oomph, but allow this all over edge to edge that we just did to be on the rest of the quilt. So let me take those off and I'm just gonna talk to you about then this center medallion here. And so I thought, well, the first thing I wanna do is kind of give it some body and structure, Kembra. So I do want to actually go ahead and stitch in the ditch and get all of this worked out. And I'm gonna do this whole interior and just ditch your star. And then what I thought was, how am I going to kind of get this to be blocked off so that it's not gonna melt into the background? And so this kind of lighter gray that you have here, Kembra, is a great little superhighway. So I can do just some very dense, small meandering stipples. And that will also give me a place that I can travel. So if I need to travel between our entry points, I can do that easily. Because what I'd like to do is to get to this point here and then start to do just an echoed kind of chevron around that shape. And at this point I thought, well, how am I gonna, because you've got this this butterfly here, and I really love how you did that butterfly because it really does kind of show it off and make it beautiful. And so I thought, well, if I did kind of the stipple out here, maybe I could use the stipple in here and just kind of travel and fill that in, and that would give me a way to get inside the block without having to break my threads, and again just kind of frame out that butterfly. And I can use that stipple to travel all the way around. So I can use that stipple to travel all the way around until I'm back out to where I started or to a new entry point or exit point. So here I would just travel. So that whenever you use any kind of dense filler, it's just a really great way to kind of sneak around when you may not have a plan for how you're gonna get from one edge to the other. So for the star behind these kind of blocks on point, I would just go ahead and do that same area, and I'm just gonna fill this in with a stipple. Repeat over here. For this interior portion, one of the things that stood out to me was how do I kind of replicate these chevrons that I'm making in that interior So I'm just going to go around here to show you kind of what I'm talking about. So with this interior, how to kind of replicate what's going on these four blocks in the center. Let me zoom in here and let's just look at that center a little bit more closely. So what I thought was, well, first I want to define the center. So first I do want to go through and define that center. And then, you know, there's seams here. There's a seam here and there's a seam here. So I can use that to my advantage as kind of it's already marked for me. I don't have to mark anything. And I thought, well, if I just repeat that chevron in that center area, it's going to give me a center star, a center focal point to this quilt. And then I thought what I'd really like to do is give myself a way to kind of frame out that center part. And so I thought, well, if I can actually go and drop in to here and then go around the outside and frame out your star, that would give me a central look to this medallion you have in the middle. So let's turn that off. I just want to show you what it wound up looking like. That was one version, by the way. I looked at this version 2, Kember, and I thought, okay, it's got, you know, the butterflies and the flowers, so maybe some kind of petally things might look good. So that's one way I started. But what I lost with this was kind of that star effect. And I wanted to kind of push this gray background fabric away to kind of push towards the eye, your star. So I didn't wind up going with that. So what I did instead, there's the center, there's the meander, and there's the final version. So that is what I like for the center. Kembra, let's take a look now up here at these corner designs, these corner blocks here. And when thinking about these corner blocks, I really thought, well, how am I going to kind of accentuate those? And let me just open up a new I'm just going to open up a new drawing layer. So I thought, well, you know, we talk about magic portals, we talk about how to drop in, and I thought if I can drop in this corner and just do a bunny hop to that point, that gets me into the area now where I can start to travel around my block. And so I'm just gonna do in this little triangle here, a lowercase L up to this point. And then what I'd like to do is drop into the center of your block here, Kembra. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna carve out a little square right there, Kembra. And then I'm gonna travel with an echoed square inside. And now I'm in this magic portal where I can drop in to the center of your quilt. And so here I'm just gonna do a bunny hop, a bunny hop, a bunny hop, a bunny hop, and then I'm gonna go to the outside. Bunny hop, bunny hop, bunny hop, bunny hop. Now I'm back and I'm gonna go back up so that I can exit this little space. And then I'm gonna do that same lowercase L over to here. I'm gonna bunny hop out, bunny hop in, lowercase L up to here. Now I'm back to that square, Kembra. And then I'm gonna echo. I've already done the center, so I don't need to do it. Lowercase L, bunny hop out, bunny hop in, lowercase L, back to a square, echo, lowercase L, bunny hop out. Oh, my bunny kind of got wayward there. Bunny hop in, lowercase L, up to here. And then Kembra, I'm gonna put that square in and the echo, lowercase L, and now I'm ready to exit. And that's how I would do that whole block in one pass. So let's take a look at how I did that one. So I'm gonna turn that one off and turn that one on. So that's what that would look like. Let's zoom out. So there we are with our center and our corners. So you can see that. Now let's turn on our background. And that's just that same kind of loopy L to the top, L to the bottom, that would cover in the background to just kind of give those stars, it would help the stars stand out, but the background would kind of fade into all of those different fabrics and not yell so much. So that background is just a simple lowercase L to the top, lowercase L to the bottom, traveling across your quilt. All right, Kimber, so let's talk about thread color, because I'm sure somebody's like, what color thread would you use here? So Kimber's quilt is full of black, white, gray, and yellow. I'm gonna turn all these off so that we can just talk about thread color. So Kimber, for your quilt, I would choose probably this deep butter yellow for the whole thing. So everything, and it'll just kind of melt into those blacks and grays and whites, and I think it'll be striking. So I think it'll be beautiful, Kimber. Kimber, you quilt your quilt however you want to quilt your quilt. But I would love to see it when you're done and see what you came up with and what you liked. But that, Kimber, is how I would quilt it if it were my quilt. So pop it over there in the clubhouse when you're done, because we all want to see it, Kimber. All right, so I do want to show you what other people have posted in our club, Quilt Joy Clubhouse, for quilts that they have finished recently. So here's some show and tell. This was posted by Inga. She says a few quilts that she's worked over the last few months for Christmas presents for family members. They all love them. I forgot to take a picture of the blue bonnet quilt before it was shipped off to my parents. It looks like you had a whole lot of fun, Inga, and I'm sure they were thrilled. Thrilled to get them. And this one is Kimbra's as well. This one says that she got her Millie 30 1 month ago. This is only her second quilt on her Millie 30. Kimber, you are doing such a great job. She says she's loving and learning as she goes. And she says, thank you so much, Angela, for being a great person with knowledge and sharing. Oh, Kimber, thank you. And she says she watches every video. All right, Kimber, thanks so much for that. And then this one is from Andrea. Andrea, she says, this was my last quilt for the year. This was for my granddaughter, and she used the Adora edge to edge and a triangle from One Song Needle Arts. So One Song Needle Arts is a company that makes digital designs. And then she played with, Andrea played with putting in a piano key between the triangles. She says she needs more practice, but she's getting there. So she's talking about here in this outside border area, she put in some piano keys. I think they look great, Andrea. I'm not sure what you need to practice, because I think it looks really, really good. So good for you. So this one is from Angela, and not me, it was a different Angela. She says, thank you for adding me to the clubhouse. I would like to share my first ever quilt. Yay, Angela. I made it for a dear friend going through breast cancer. She loves butterflies and hummingbirds. I had no help, teachers, or instruction. Oh my goodness. I realize it is not perfect, but I am proud. Every square is embroidered. All I can do is grow from here. I'm not working in the best of conditions. My table's too small. I have a mechanical machine, but it's the best I can do. Angela, I think you're doing great. And don't discount the older machines. I started quilting on my grandma's old Singer. And to do free motion quilting, I had to put a cardstock over the feed dogs so that the feed dogs wouldn't lift up, so that I could hover with my grandma's Singer and do free motion quilting. So where there's a will, there's a way, and you're doing a great job. Angela, thanks so much for sending that in. This one is from Emily. Emily, she says, he's finished. I completed the top last year and quilted it this fall. I used a combination of free motion and ruler work on this one. I'm very happy with how he turned out. Oh, he looks like a very happy, happy Santa. Emily, good job. I bet you enjoyed snoozing under him for this season. Allison says, this is my first free motion quilt. You know, Allison, this is such a good way to learn free motion. So what Allison did here was take those shapes, those applique shapes, and echo them. And that is such a good exercise to kind of get your eyeball looking ahead of the needle, to anticipate when a curve is going to happen, to fill that space. Really good way to learn and practice and play, Allison, with free motion. Good job. This one is from Marie, and Marie says she bound both of those today. She'll be going to these quilts will be going to their forever homes on Monday, and they are all about a throw size. What a great job you did, Marie. I love the hexagon one especially. It has a lot of great kind of toying with the eye and the optical illusion of it all. Really nice, Marie. Thank you for posting those. And then Andrea posted this one. She says, this is my third Christmas quilt for a grandchild. He chose the panel. And I use my quilt path to eclipse the background pattern. So that's like a no-sew zone. And it's called West Wind at Night with a variety of different patterns to eclipse in for the sun, the planets, and the galaxies. Oh, I bet he loved it. I really like how you use that kind of, cathedral windows kind of design, orange peel design for the moon. Super nice, Andrea. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for posting that. Well, I would love to see you on February the 1st. That's when we're going to meet back up again. Again, I can't do the January 2nd session that we normally do because I will be teaching that day in Cave City, Kentucky. So February the 1st at 1 o'clock Eastern. So join us. We will be on our YouTube channel, on our website, our Facebook page, and our Facebook group. So you can also join us over on any of our social channels. You can join us on Instagram, where we post a lot of great photos of some of our renters and all the quilts they're working on, as well as all of those other YouTube videos that we have for the past Clubhouse recordings. You can watch all of those past ones there on YouTube. All right, you guys, thank you so much for joining me. I hope you had a happy holiday and happy new year, and I will see you on February the 1st, 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. Bye.